field of higher education globally, the ways in which organizational studies and organizational theories, as well as their main successors, emerged from close study of US higher education institutions in the 60s and 70s, which has endured as the essential analytical paradigm. This global, within quotation marks, paradigm and the enthusiasm for globalization seem to consistently underestimate the enduring salience of attempts to articulate and implement national strategies in the higher education sector and in the related areas of national mobility programs and national innovation systems. That globalization paradigm has also underestimated or perhaps simply failed to carefully study the complex and subtle ways in which regional and local governments, local business and industries, and higher education institutions have all interacted in the new context. The BRICS volume attempts to explore in depth and in detail precisely these gaps in our understanding. The chapters in the edited volume also raise exceptionally important points about the historical legacies and path dependencies within the various systems, the role of the state or party state, power, conflicts around social exclusion and inclusion, and ongoing negotiations around system-wide principles, policies, and practices. An especially important theme throughout is the relative lack of good data or reliable information of what is actually happening within colleges, universities, and classrooms. How, amid rapid privatization and diversification, we know relatively little about what students are actually doing or learning, perhaps especially around student learning outcomes and longer-term career paths. As Simon Schwarzman remarks, there are undeniably powerful and shared global dynamics, yet their role is limited by the resilience of existing cultures, institutions, and stakeholders, as well as by their own financial limitations. This illuminates very clearly the essential tension. Illuminates very clearly the essential tension or dynamics at play throughout all the various cases. The attempts in all of the BRICS nations to articulate coherent national and global strategies for the tertiary sector, which is complicated precisely by the limits of state funding and steering mechanisms in a context of rapid expansion and partial globalization, and all of which unfolds amid the at least rhetorical and conceptual embrace of market and neoliberal principles. This later point highlights another large anomaly looming over much of this, and that regards the role of the United States. While the United States is undeniably at the heart of the global higher education system, as a nation, the United States lacks any coherent national strategy around this. And has been systematically cutting funding for international education, the study of foreign languages, and the Fulbright and other programs. Since the end of the Cold War, the United States has relied upon market mechanisms and a laissez-faire attitude, while at the same time seeking to dominate those allegedly neutral market processes through GATS and the combined power of the United States and England corporate interests. To university expansion programs, for-profit providers, publishing and testing conglomerates, and now the MOOCs. This, of course, means that the BRIC nations and many others are in the position of having to respond or engage with these global forces to maintain the coherence and integrity of their national systems, which most of them have done reasonably well, to regulate and manage the presence of global or other for-profit providers, and to establish and fund new state-funded global mobility programs to engage more purposefully or strategically with this global process of change, and to create programs to attract back their often far-flung diasporas of scientific and professional talent. Again, the edited volume does an exceptional job of navigating throughout these themes and continuously highlights the difficulty, especially of regulating the growing and often non-transparent private and for-profit providers. I will stop here. There are other considerations which I will share with you in printed form. Thank you very much, and let's start with the Chinese case. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Schwarzman. now Professor Qiang Zha will talk to us about the role of national and regional governments in higher education policy and implementation. You have 30 minutes.
Thank you, Chairperson. And also, I'd like to thank Professor Schwarzman for involving me in this project, significant project, and invite me to this event. Professor Schwarzman assigned me three readings when he asked me to prepare this presentation. One is the his own chapter, which is chapter two in this book, which is a general framework about this book and project. And the second piece of reading is the chapter by Professor Mark Johnson, who is not being able to be here today, which is about a Russian and higher education policy. And last chapter is the one co-authored by Professor Ruth Heihu and myself, which is more about China, and the focus on the higher education policy and implementation in China. That's the focus. So admittedly, it gave me a hard time initially. I was thinking hard how to reconcile all the three chapters and framework my presentation. So this is what I came up for the as a framework for this presentation, which I'm going to talk in next 30 minutes or so. I want to reflect on the Chinese higher education policy and implementation from a macro, meso, and micro perspective. Let me explain a little bit about my framework. By macro, I mean the global trends, the global tendency. So for that part, I will make reference on the chapter written by Professor Schwarzman, and also I referenced the Global Higher Education Report prepared by Philip Adbach and his associates in 2009 for UNESCO. Can you hear me, the people in the back? Okay, good, sounds good. And for the MISO perspective, I try to draw on the chapter by Professor Mark Johnson. And move on to the micro perspective, which is about China. I can justify why I take the Russian thing as the MISO perspective, because China, back to the 50s, China modeled on the Russian patterns. And these two countries, when we started the reform process, we both experienced the so-called de-Sovietization process. So in that sense, I can justify, because Russia used to be a model for China. So that's the MISO way. So in that context, I will talk about the relevance or irrelevance of the Chinese policy. So that's the context of my presentation. So I'm gonna move on. Okay, so in that sense, I have a framework, right? So you see this chart, the left column would be the global trends, the global details. The middle one will be the Russian one, the MISO perspective, and the right end will be the Chinese. I let you read by yourself, okay? That's a joke, right? So I do have one here. Hopefully you can read. You see, I roughly pick up two periods time. One is the 1990s, and the second one is the first decade of 21st century. That's basically the time framework laid out by Professor Mark Johnson in his chapter. Let's just look at roughly in the 1990s. Right here, okay? So I pick up the global trends as the hyper-expansion or the massification of higher education, mostly driven by the trends towards increasing democratization, human rights, scientization, and development of planning, right? And expansion by the general education. So you can see that's, against that global trends, you can see a quite similar responses in both Russia and China. Right. In terms of Russia, Russia inherited a quite developed, a mature higher education system. As I mentioned in the previous session, it's already quite developed, a large system of higher education. So in that sense, in that context, the Russia continued the traditional manpower planning approach to organizing and managing higher education through the linking higher education institutions to the specific branches of the economy. As opposed to in China, when China started the reform process in the early 80s or late 70s, the higher education system was pretty small and humble. So starting from that time, the Chinese government granted high priority to the higher education sector for the sake of the economic growth needs, expanding enrollment at an annual rate of 17%. It's very high. Between 1998 and to 2010. And during the peak period for this expansion, the fiscal appropriations increasing at an annual rate of 17.4% between 1998 and 2006. That's keeping the pace with the increase of the enrollment. And also increasing or expanding the capacity of the universities through boosting comprehensiveness in curricular and program offerings, and delinking from the specific branches of economy, which is different approaches from the Russia policy or practice. The second role is the right here. That's the differentiation and academic drift. I think our colleagues in the previous session talked about that a little bit, especially Professor Schwarzman talked that. In the Russia context, there is a hierarchy, clear hierarchy of universities. It's still there and stayed. And also, the Russia allowed the higher education sector to grow within this landscape. In China, Chinese government launched the elite higher education schemes. For those who are familiar with that, you must have heard the project 211, project 985. The elite universities, they have the concentration of the public resources in order to heighten their status to world class standing. And fostering a steep hierarchical structure. I want to show you here a graphic. You can see the structure of Chinese higher education is now a quite steep hierarchy. It used to be a hierarchy like a Russian one, but it's getting more steep. If I can, just roughly, I can say the previous higher education sector, I mean, prior to reform, could be this part. It is hierarchy, but now it's more steep. And you can see we have different layers on the top. That's Project 985, and those universities are supposed to aim at world-class standing. Of course, all the systems, all the governments would experience limitations on their fiscal capability or ability. Right? How to deal with the fiscal limitations, how to regulate the market for the private sector or privatization. Yeah, how to make the higher education institutions more accountable. So these are all the common issues in that context. And we can see quite similar responses in both Russia and China. In Russia, that's called reinventing higher education, right? Featuring the experimentations and sometimes chaotic efforts to reconfigure university business and university community partnerships. Those ideas I got from Professor Mark Johnson's chapter. I know we have some Russian colleagues here. If I'm wrong, you can correct me any moment. And also, there was a weak regulatory oversight due to the weakened state authority in that period of time. And also in Russia, there was a higher education law issued or existing since 1996. It's quite similar, you will see when I talk about China. And also in Russia, started allowing private institutions. And we can see quite a similar responses in China. There was a decentralization throughout the 1990s, and Chinese government issued the higher education law in 1997. Very similar, amazingly similar, right? For Russia, it's 96, for China, it's 97. And also Chinese government allowed, starting from the 90s, allowed the private institutions. Okay, let's move on to the first decade of 21st thousand. Understandably, the governments everywhere, they continue the efforts to work on the regulatory framework. And this time, the focus slightly shifted more about how to deal with the expansion and the equity of access, how to improve and maintain the equality and the social relevance of learning and research in higher education sector. And you can see in Russia, this is the idea I got from Dr. Johnson's chapter, reasserting the state power, leveraging on the global neoliberal toolbox, such as new auditing procedures, academic program evaluations, performance indicators, and competitive funds for research and innovative institutions, and granting priority to higher education sector, absorbing 21.1% of the country's all education expenditure. I don't want to jump too much into the details, but you can see in my chart. And also starting a sharp differentiation process between the federal and the local institutions. So leading to the creation of a three-tier system of higher education institutions in the country. And for the quality insurance sector, developing a national testing system and also bending the Academy of Sciences Research Institutes towards the integration with the leading universities in the country. So this is something, some details we can observe in the Russia context. Let's move on to the Chinese context. Also, we have quite similar actions we can observe, the government-led auditing evaluation practices. And also the Chinese government launched, quite recently launched a binary system through mandatory creation of University of Applied Sciences. I will talk a little bit more later on in this presentation, and also I think my colleagues, Professor Yu Caizhou, can talk more on those policy initiatives. And also the growth of the private institutions. I believe in 2003, the Chinese government issued a law on creating the private institutions. So that somehow boosted the creation of the private institutions in the country. But they, even though all the private institutions, they remain marginal in the system in terms of status. And more recently, there's a movement of chartering of Chinese universities, and all the Chinese universities are supposed to have their own charters to defend their territory of their own affairs or university autonomy. You can say that because it's arguable whether or not a Chinese university enjoy authentic autonomy. And also you can see emerging divergence of the state, local, and institutional interests, which is something you might not be able to observe back to the early days, like the 50s, the 60s, even 70s, even 80s. You will see a quite high degree consistency in terms of the state, local, institutional interest, because that time we call the so-called planned economy time. But now we can see a kind of divergence, not as much as democratic Western societies, but we can see this is happening. The rest are more detailed and simple. For the increase in student mobility, we can see Russia is now joining the Bologna process. Well, in China, we all, well, ever starting the early 80s, Chinese government have several large-scale, the state-led initiatives and programs for the student international mobility. I will talk a bit more and give some figures, but I want to highlight one thing. Within a short framework, China might be a very real example that I can achieve the balance of outgoing students and incoming students. So nowadays, you are looking at every year approximately 400,000 Chinese students going abroad, approximately the same amount of students coming to China. That's quite amazing. Within short timeline, you can achieve such a balance. The next thing would be the transnational higher education. Right, and in Russia, I read something from Dr. Johnson's chapter. There is such a thing in Russia, but mostly marginal and controlled. But in China, it's fashionable and proliferating. As my colleague Rupa mentioned when she compared India and China, all right, this is very spreading quickly in China. I will give some figures later on and in more slides. Next will be the global rankings. I don't have information from Dr. Johnson's chapter, but I noticed one thing in his chapter, that top tier of national research universities in Russia is dominated by specialized institutions in key scientific and technological fields. This is completely different in the Chinese context. We prefer comprehensive university. Comprehensiveness in terms of curricular and program offerings. I guess that could be one reason behind the scene that enable Chinese universities to perform much better in the global ranking legal tables. Here, so I want to quote the most recent statement by QS. In the QS Global Ranking BRICS report, which says China dominance, the QS university ranking with 6 of the top 10, the BRIC report, not overall report, okay, BRIC report. So China has 6 in the top 10, which is ahead of the Brazil. Brazil has 2, Russia has 1, and South Africa has 1 as well. This is only my speculation, right? So according to Dr. Johnson, the top tier universities in Russia now remain specialized. Okay, next thing would be the finance of higher education, right? Every country, every system now experiencing the finance limitations or constraints. And also they have to rely on privatization in order to fill out the financial gap. You can see in the Russia context, introducing business-like managerial practices, look for additional sources for income, the growing of the private institutions. Right, but in Russia context, some private institutions, they can become the top tier institutions. A few, maybe a couple, right? But this is not the case in China. All the Chinese private institutions, they remain at the bottom in the hierarchy, quite marginal. And I will talk a little bit more about finance in later on in more slides, but I want to quote a pretty common and popular Chinese wisdom to highlight China's response to the financial limitations, which is concentrate resources to accomplish a large undertakings. I will explain more. I think I missed one thing, which is brand circulation, right? I don't have any information about such a thing in Russia, but I can see in China, this is a very important government tool to join in the global brand circulation, right? As I said, China, ever since the early 80s, China started sending a large number of students study abroad. Now China is now experiencing harvest such a brand circulation and see more and more global talents flowing back. And finally, I want to just mention the spreading academic corruption. And you can observe in both countries. I think it's mentioned in Dr. Johnson's chapter, but in China, and there are more cases, yeah. And also they are causing serious damages to the system, Chinese higher education system. So I just quickly went through this checklist. So basically, you can see in a global framework and the context, the two countries, they shared many similarities, featured many quite similar responses to the global trends. One thing I want to highlight as a difference between the two countries might be a strong state. A very strong state in the Chinese context. I will talk a little bit more about that. That's a very strong feature of the Chinese model. And the other thing is oscillations, right? You can see in both countries, you might be able to observe some oscillation, especially about the control relaxing control of higher education sector. You can see oscillations, it can be observed in both systems. I apologize for this kind of complicated process. I have to move back and forth. So now I'm going to highlight some details in the Chinese context after such a brief comparison. First of all, we can talk about expansion. Right? China now is kind of the example for the dramatic expansion of the higher education system. Right? You can see a quite amazing effect. Professor Yan and myself, we co-authored a chapter on the tournament effect. This is again about the consistency of the state, local, and institutional interest. So why China can achieve such a dramatic expansion of higher education enrollment in such a short framework, very efficient, very effective, and there's a, such a thing called a tournament effect, which means the when this is totally based on the state initiative, right? When the state government set out a policy goal, the local government would act immediately on that and even add something towards that goal. And this is a similar situation for the institutions, right? So in that way, the country can achieve amazingly the fast expansion of higher education enrollment, right? So now we can see, as I have some figures here, right? The gross enrollment, 36 million. Right, 1,202 universities and 1,327 colleges in 2014. In terms of enrollment, we are China is the largest one. In terms of the number of institutions, China is second. Right, as mentioned, India is the largest one. And differentiation, yeah, we talked about creating a steep hierarchy of university and higher education structure. Next thing is the equity of access. It's a dilemma in many places. And the Chinese response featured a few things, like the National College Entrance Examination. It has been there since the late 70s. In a sense, it's quite a powerful device, even though there are many debates about that, whether or not we should update, improve this system. But fundamentally, it's a quite powerful device to ensure equity. In terms of entrance to higher education institutions. Most recently, the central government set up such a policy with mandatory quota for the elite universities to recruit students from underdeveloped region. That you have to. Maybe later on, Professor Yan can talk a bit about his own university. There's a quota there. You have to recruit, bring in students from underdeveloped area. We talk about that. Finance, right? Finance is a big headache for many systems. In China, as I mentioned, we have this kind of the wisdom, concentrating resources to accomplish large undertakings. Let me give you an example of this. Maybe figures are bad examples. Can you see that? Oh, it's not a big table, so I can read some figures. This is the latest information about Chinese universities' revenues. I have converted them into US dollars. Here I pick up top 10. Right, then on the top is Tsinghua University in Beijing. Its last year's revenue was $2,755 million. Or put a simple way, that's almost 2.8 billion US dollars. Yeah, 2.8 billion US dollars. Yeah. The next one is Zhejiang University. It's about approximately 2.5 billion US dollars. While the third one is Professor Yan's University, Peking University. It's approximately 2 billion US dollars. Now followed by Shanghai Jiao Tong, 1.9 billion. Fudan, 1.2 billion. And Wuhan, about 1.1 billion. And we're talking about US dollars, right? Jilin is about 1.1. Huazhong is 1.1. And the Dr. Sun Yixian's university in Guangzhou is about 1 billion. And the last one in the top 10 list is Sichuan University, which is about 1 billion. So I convert all in the US dollars. If I convert into Canadian dollars, I think all the top 20 can make more than $1 billion. And in the country I'm now living in Canada, I guess only less than 5 universities can make more than $1 billion Canadian dollars in a year. The second thing I want to mention about in the finance sector is about the Keynesian model. I don't have time to elaborate that model, but I suggest you can read Simon Marginson's paper in higher education. He elaborated the Keynesian model. About the finance is, you know, you can argue how come Chinese government is so rich, right? They're pouring so much money into the top universities. What about the rest, right? There are so many higher education institutions there. One thing from Keynesian model is households, they are willing to support their kids' education. They could use every penny of their savings to support their kids' education. So they fill out a large financial gap, especially for the lower tier universities, local universities. They're coming, a large proportion of their revenues coming from the households' savings. Oh, the other, next thing I want to talk about is the privatization and internationalization. We talked about in the 90s, there was a movement or campaign of decentralization, and that campaign boosted privatization. So today, we can see about 300 independent colleges. By decentralization, I mean not only the local governments, they have more say about higher education, and also institutions, they have more say about their own institutions. Affairs. And some universities took advantage of that. They created so-called independent colleges. They are college, university colleges, but within the public university. They are private nature, but within the public university. You try to figure out that. I know it's a bit complicated, but only with the decentralization, with this kind of the autonomy university could enjoy, they could, public universities could create private sector within itself. And also, you can see more purely private institutions, so 445 in total. So put them all together, it's almost 700, right? More than 700 private institutions. Internationalization. This is another thing I want to highlight, because we are now doing a project with my colleague Rupa and Sheila. China, in a sense, is using internationalization for experimentation purpose. I mean, in a sense, China still has kind of rigid policy context. But for internationalization, you can have this kind of experiments on the Chinese soil without taking too much risks. So now you can see 577 universities and colleges in China, they are involved offering the transnational programs or even the independent and entities with a legal person status. There should be a dozen like this, like Shanghai, New York, Ningbo, Nottingham, this kind of the independent entities in China. And among the 577, this is quite interesting, 79 are elite universities. They are top. Actually, they should not worry about their revenues. They should not worry about reputation or status, but still they're involved in this kind of the initiatives and offering the transnational programs. In terms of the internationalization, another thing would be the brand mobility, right? As I mentioned, I will give some figures. So ever since the middle of the 1990s, Chinese state supported over 160,000 students and scholars to study abroad. And this figure is 25,000 in 2015 alone. And China is now starting harvest of such brand circulation. Those people who went abroad in the early days, now they are scholars in their own field. They start coming back or collaborating with the Chinese partners and colleagues. Accountability. Roughly, I divide such policy themes following the framework set out by Professor Schwarzman in his chapter, right? Now, the next one is the accountability and quality assurance and the social relevance. So in China, pretty much responding to the global trends and similar to what's happening in Russia, there's a state-led accountability framework. So you could see all kinds of the auditing missions, right? The government now appointing the inspectors to the private institutions. That's for the quality assurance, but also for the control purpose. You have the government-controlled assessment programs. I don't have time to talk about that, but maybe later on we can share and discuss that in the Q&A time. And more recently, there's a state-initiated binary system, and that's more about the relevance of the higher education sector. Because in the expansion that China now has a lot more new universities, how to ensure relevance of their educational programs. So this is a new initiative, the very ambitious. The goal is to convert around 600 local universities into the so-called university applied sciences, which is more like a European style, European type. Finally, this government steering university industry partnerships. This is pretty much like different from the many Western societies. You have to work that out based on the institutional incentives or the scholars' individual incentives. This is very much fostered by, pushed by the government. I guess my time is quite limited. So I want to skip that. So this is the graphic from Dr. Schwarzman's chapter, mostly about the enrollment growth in Russia and China. I'm not going to use that graphics in that sense. So basically, I want to use that graph to highlight the development tendency in the both systems. So the right line is Russia, the blue line is Russia, right? You see, it's making progress, dramatic progress, but you can also observe some stagnations from time to time. As opposed to China, it's more linear and straightforward. So in that sense, you can claim China would have a success story, right? How can we elaborate, interpret that success story? As I mentioned in my previous part, the secret one is a strong state, right? The second one is the Confucian model. We don't have time to elaborate on that. And the third one I just added here is kind of pragmatism or eclecticism. Roughly, I can say it's about experimentation with all different available models. China has quite a unique experience. Ever starting from the early 20th century, China experimented with different the foreign models, right? First Japan, then Europe, then US, then Soviet Union, then back to North America. So China experimented with all kinds of the international models, and China has, again, rich experience towards that end. But just one final slide. Yeah, just one more minute, yeah. So that explain somehow many factors behind the so-called success stories behind the China scene. But how could you explain the oscillations? As I mentioned to you, there's obviously oscillations. How to explain that? So here I have another graphic about that. I referenced the framework created by some Australian scholars. This is quite amazing. You can use that in parallel with Martin Chou's phases of higher education development, right? Martin Chou's is more about measurement. It's about the quantity aspect. Here you can see this kind of the ideology for the different statement, different stages, right? They have only the outer three, right? You have the liberal stage. This is more about access. You have the social justice is more about the participation. And finally, you have the final goal, which is the human potential. It's more about success. Here I add a call as a political philosophy, which is the emphasis is put on the service function. I reference that part with Brubaker's book about philosophy, political philosophy of higher education. So the point here is this is like Earth system, right? The gravity is actually here. Right. So when, at this point, we can see both China and Russia could be in this layer, but China is lower and Russia is higher because Russia got a quite developed system ever since the 80s or 90s. Right. So the point here is the lower of your attitude, the more you feel the gravity, right? The more you have these kind of oscillations, right? The higher in the system, you could feel less gravity, and you don't have that much oscillations you can observe. So that's pretty much the explanation about the oscillations of both systems. But obviously, China experiencing more. The challenges I want to talk in the Q&A time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Qiang Jia, for just exceeding 5 minutes. Oh.
I apologize for that. Only 5 minutes.
Now we look forward to have comments, and we hope to stick for 10 minutes for each of our distinguished mentors, Yu Zhongkai, and Professor Fengwin Yang. Please go ahead. Who will start first?
Okay.
There's a timer there.
Oh, yes. Okay, yes. I will keep an eye on it. So it's 10 minutes.
To raise the flag.
Yeah, hopefully I will save some time. But thank you very much. And I have the honor to be here and to be the commentator on the Chinese higher education reforms. And I appreciate and also value the presentation made by Professor Zha, because this is a very good review of Chinese higher education reforms, not only from the Chinese perspective, but also put the reform in the international context. So it's better to understand what's going on in China. And I want to be a bit modest to make any comments on such excellent presentation, because I have been also living in Finland for 13 years, and also I have been away from China for 15 years, but still I have some ties with Chinese higher education. I was educated in China, got my first higher education degree there, and also I used to work in a Chinese university, and also I also worked 7 years in the provincial government, the education department, so I was dealing with the higher education issues, so, from the governmental perspective. Also, I have been studying Chinese higher education, even though I have been away for 15 years. So I have been using the 15 years to study the higher education in China, but from the external perspective. So maybe, it might be an advantage, for me, so I can have, the cross-cultural perspective to go back to China to reflect on the reforms. There's a lot of things going on in China, and we have already seen a lot of achievement, but also there are some challenges as well. So I think I would like to take the next few minutes to talk about some potential challenges in the Chinese higher education reform. I'm not going to talk some details, the quality of education, employment of graduates, and autonomy, all these issues, but I want to talk some more the reforms more on the general level about the model of the reform, about the relations between the government and higher education. So I have three things I want to not only to criticize or something, but I just want to ask questions to my colleagues and the audience. The first one is, I think we have seen that in the book, we all talk about higher education reforms. Basically, we see higher educations or higher education institutions are responding to the societal needs. This is the basis, this is the initial drive for higher education to change, because we want to better serve the societal needs. But in the Chinese case, possibly also in some other contexts, we see the reform actually is mainly to respond to the governmental wish or their directives. So in a way, so the first challenge, if we do not call the problem, is whether the higher education reforms are taking place in a way that the government become the proxy of a society, meaning that the government translate the societal needs to the reform. So for the universities, they are just working hardly to see how we can respond to the governmental policies rather than directly to understand what is exactly going on in the society and how we respond to the societal needs. So this might be the challenge, because this is still something, you know, continual in China. I have been involved in the recent reform, for example, the in the studies about the reform of transforming the regional university. China, from last year, has launched a reform to transform 600 regional universities to become, you know, application-oriented, more vocational-oriented. So it's a very big reform, but it took place, you know, suddenly, and I was involved in the research and also a training program, because China has taken Finland. I'm from Finland. Taken Finland as a role model, so they also want to learn how Finland has transformed or established their universities of applied sciences, and how the lessons and experience can be used for China. So I was in the training program, and first in China with 100 university leaders, and then later in the spring this year in Finland with 25 Chinese university leaders. I had a very close contact with the Chinese university leaders who are in the reform. I understand that the university leaders, they are smart, you know, they really, you know, I think they know what they are going on, but it sometimes respond to the society takes the time. And they should have, I trust that they have their capacity if they are in the position, you know, to understand what the university should be run and how they respond to the society. But now I found that they had no time to really understand the societal needs, but just studying the policies and to see actually how they can make the best, the most benefits from the policy. In terms of funding, if they are already in the first round of experimental project, how much money they can get from the government. I think that might be the risk for the reform. So this is my first, you know, maybe I can call it observation. And the second is also related to that, is because the government becomes a proxy of the society. So, for many reforms, you know, my guess or my observation is, you know, people are just working on the reform actions without thinking seriously about why we have the reform. So, what we are going to do? So, what the reform is for? So, in a way, though, we can say that it's. We do not know, even though we do not know where we are going, but we move fast. So this, anything, you know, can take place very fast, but the few people really know, you know, what we are going. So that can also be the problem. And this is also dangerous in a way that we are being, basically there might be, you know, leaking of a consensus, you know, or the ideology building before, you know, some actions taken place. So this is my second comment. And the last one is related, you know, to the solution. So basically this is about how we somehow to deal with the relations between the government and the universities. So I admit, acknowledge the important role of government. Government is very important. You know, they should play some coordination roles, translate the societal needs into the reforms, but not the only, you know, source for doing so. But actually, government is already part of the environment of higher education and the university, so they should, you know, play such a role. But the problem is what relations, you know, they should have. We have a lot of literature about the governance models, but from the academic perspective, I want to ask whether the higher education governance literature has provided us sufficient tools to understand the relations, or we still need some other insights. And I have no answer, but recently I'm studying the innovation, you know, studies literature, for example, the triple helix. I found the triple helix model might, you know, be useful for higher education researchers to better understand the relations between different sectors like government, university and industry. Normally people think triple helix offers nothing, but you know, just about the relations between the three sectors, which we have already seen taking place everywhere. But actually the one essence of the triple helix is not simply about the relations between the three actors, it's about what kind of relations. So I do not want to go deep, but just raise the question. Maybe you know, it's time for us to rethink how we should help, you know, from the academic perspective, to develop some good model to understand the relations and to help, you know, university better respond to the society. So that's the end. I think I still have some seconds left.
Great.
Thank you.
He has to be applauded for that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now we hope to applaud you as well. Please.
Thank you very much for inviting me to participate in this important conference. I like the talk by two previous my colleagues. They review Chinese higher education policy in the background of internationalization and social exchange. And I would like to share with you 4 points on the project and also on Chinese higher education expansion and changes. And the first point is why we do study break higher education in BRICS countries. I think this five countries, they draw our attention international attention because of their economic growth. So those five countries, they have a very strong economy. In past decades, they made big progress in their economy, and hopefully they can make even bigger progress in the future. So we higher education experts and scholars come together to study the relationship between higher education on the one side and economy on the other side. So we have a strong assumption: higher education make great contribution to economy. That's not conclusion, I think. That's only a question. Any relationship between economy and higher education, we can explore. And I'm happy project research, and as Simon concluded, and there are two perspectives to study higher education and economy. And the dominant model, theoretical model, is a functional model. So we can say economy need human capital. Higher education produce human capital. So higher education can contribute to economy. Or in other words, those five countries, they have strong economy, so they have strong higher education system or higher education progress. I think that's two different perspective to study higher education and economy. And the dominant theoretical thought is functional, but we scholars come from a particular country and a particular system, so we can look at the process. And I say that's the institutional perspective. And I give one example to argue why institutional perspective works for Chinese system. And I think two theoretical models work for to explain why Chinese higher education expand. And functional perspective can explain Chinese higher education expansion and growth. in terms of a private rate of return and a public rate of return. In past decades, Chinese private return rate of return for higher education is obvious growing, and so public rate of return is also very positive. So we can say higher education make contribution to economy, but on the other side, that's not enough. Functional perspective is not enough for us to interpret higher education. I'm arguing institutional process perspective also work for us to interpret Chinese higher education, because Chinese higher education expansion started in the year 1999. What's the time? What's special for the time? That's 2 years after Asian financial crisis. So that's a very special occasion for Chinese higher education to expand. Why? Because at that moment, China has a problem in economy. There is no stimulus for economy to grow continuously and sustainably. So the government borrowed the higher education as a stimulus to the economy. In policy makers, their mind, higher education is a big consumer. They can consume a lot of goods, students, their transportation, their dormitory, and their many stuffs students use, and also the employment. So in policy makers' mind, they believe higher education can contribute to the economy. If we didn't pay attention to this special moment, we probably ignore. We can use institutional perspective or process perspective to interpret why Chinese higher education expand in the year 1999, and after that, the process maintain and continue in a decade, and China eventually achieved the massification objective. That's my second point. I think this project use a different perspective to study higher education phenomena. That's very interesting to global knowledge, and we have advantage to study higher education from inside. The third point is, if we look at the Chinese higher education expansion, I believe the point made by Simon and Qiang are very relevant. That's the differentiation or decentralization in Chinese context. If you look at the statistical data, in the Chinese central universities and colleges take a very small percentage of total system. That's less than 10%. And on the other side, provincial institutions and provincial enrollments take a very large share of the system. That's more than 19%. And why this structure? And before that, China follow Russia model is a very centralized system. And gradually, Chinese system becomes decentralized. And if we look at the phenomena from functional perspective, I don't think that can explain this phenomena very well. And I totally agree we can borrow a different institutional perspective to study this issue. And the reason, the direct reason for this change is in the 1998, and the Chinese political government changed its structure. A lot of industry ministries, they have been abolished. And universities, they used to be affiliated to the industry ministries. They have to change their affiliation. So they change their affiliation from the central government to provincial government. If we don't look at this issue in detail, we might just say Chinese system is changed by human design. That's not true. I think that's the evolution perspective can explain. And finally, I respond to Qiang's request. And China, when Chinese higher education expand, and the equity become an issue for the society. And because students from well-off family, from the rich regions, from the coastal areas, they have advantage to go to universities and colleges. By contrary, the students from poor family, from the remote regions, they have less opportunity to go to colleges. And the Chinese government work with universities and also work with societies to make up several ways to solve the problem. And one is, as Qiang mentioned, the government encouraged universities to have a quota to students from remote areas and from poor families. I think that's a very new initiative that can contribute to narrow down the gap between regions. And the second aspect is because China is an urbanizing society, and more and more rural areas become cities. So many farmers, they moved from the countryside to the cities. So they bring their family to the cities and their kids to the cities. And in the past, their kids don't have any opportunity to take national examination in the city. They have come back to their hometown, farm to take examinations. That's very tough for them, for their family, because they were educated in the city. And gradually, the government changed the policy. They can stay in the city, and they can take examination in the city. I think that's a very important aspect for China to increase its equity. And also, I think there are some other measures the government take to equalize the gap between city and rural areas. For example, there is one program that's a hand-in-hand program. That means the elite universities in Beijing, Shanghai, they have partnership with universities in Xinjiang and Tibet. And so they can work together, and especially elite universities can help the provincial universities to promote their quality, their excellence. And by this kind of way, universities in rural areas and in remote areas, they can make progress. I think Chinese government and institutions and societies, they work together to solve the problem. And that's also one argument, I think, that's the institutional perspective we can interpret Chinese education, its outcome, and its relevance. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the valuable comments we have received, and thank you for exceeding our main presenter in the time that you have exceeded. Well, I will not use my authority as the chairman to ask questions first. So what I will first leave the floor to our main speaker to comment on what you have heard, if you want, and then open the floor for a first round of questions. I think we have about 20 minutes to go, so we have ample.
We open the floor. I guess we give more time for interactions.
I just wanted to make sure that you're comfortable. Okay, can we please have everybody's...
I have been listening to him, all the positive aspects of the Chinese higher education system. But as I have read, you know, that there are many Chinese authors who have questioned the world-class university, the concept of implementation of world-class university in a system like China, you know, number one. Does China really need world-class university? When we look at the revenue generated by a couple of universities, on the other side, there is a huge investment that has been carried out for more than 15 years by government of China, you know, number one. Number two, the concept of world-class university in Chinese is basically a government policy. It's not an institutional policy. It has not come out from the institution from grassroots level. Rather, it has been enforced by the government to follow a specific world-class university concept. Now, there is as he was telling, there is larger scale disparity between the provincial universities, you know, universities in different provinces in terms of access and in terms of quality. Access to higher education in China is a big issue, just like India, you know. Unemployment rate is a very big issue in China. The labor market is also not responding to most of the universities' graduates like what we are facing in India, you know. Unfortunately, very few data I have been able to read, you know, on unemployment rate and other things. But I know that unemployment rate in China is equally high. The labor market is not able to absorb. So that reflection, that is largely from the provincial universities. Fine. So how is the government planning to address the problems of the provincial universities, you know, bearing these 8-10 world-class universities, you know? What are the plans of the government to address the quality of these provincial universities and to link the output of these provincial universities to the labor market? These are the two questions that I have.
Have more questions? Okay, maybe I can take my chance now to complement what you have said here, because you have said you are trying to concentrate the resources on development, which is really heading towards upright rather than horizontal reform. And that, of course, is a mandatory requirement, because you know the government cannot really cater for the whole education system. But what is the critical mass of this upright, focusing the resources, and as compared to the quality of the overall system? Is there a critical mass that the government is looking at to make sure that the bulk of the system has a certain minimum of quality delivery? Because, of course, this focusing the resources is just acting like the pillars that will take the whole system upright. The second issue is the perception of the labor market. I mean, it's a problem, it's a universal problem in all developing countries that there are no sufficient jobs, and we are mostly demand-driven rather, input-driven rather than demand-driven, education being a mandatory requirement by constitutions and so forth. So what is the government doing to secure, particularly to secure the quality of the overall system? Because I'm sure that you will have upright qualities, but my concern is what policies are to be taken to address the whole system so that it's not a big burden on the overall, and you graduate the qualities that are needed by the labor market. Any questions to add so that we can give him the chance to respond? Sorry? Yes.
It's in a computer. It's in a computer.
I think at the end, Professor Schwarzman will share all the presentations with all of us. I'm sure he will have a way to announce that they will be shared at a certain site of the academy, or he will send it to all the participants. So but the answer is yes, you're going to get. I hope I'm saying the right thing. Okay. Okay, so our presenter, maybe you'll have another third question so that he will.
Thank you very much. First, I want to thank the first presenter for very interesting discourse of desovietization of the higher education. It's an interesting perspective. But my question is to the last commentator or presenter. You made really intriguing point about the reasons of the expansion in 1999. So am I correct that you essentially argue that the functional approach when we consider higher education as function of the labor market, more or less, doesn't explain that. And you provide the explanation, but I understood your explanation also as economic explanation, that these young people will be unemployed otherwise, and as a students, they will be taken care of, and in addition, their families will participate in the economics around higher education. What are the alternative explanations, additional alternative explanations for that?
Address a little bit about the relevance of higher education, as well as the quality in, assurance issues. Maybe my colleague, Professor Tse, can add something on that. And I will leave the what class university to my colleague, Professor Yan, because his university is among the elite ones who aim to be one. Yeah, he might be in a better position to answer that. And also, I would suggest, you know, Dr. He Jing from Ford Foundation Beijing office, he might be able to help address the perception of the world-class university. Because we chatted quite a bit in a bus and coming to this place, and he has some quite interesting thoughts about that. Okay, let me just touch upon the first point about relevance and quality assurance. Relevance is really important issue or dilemma in the Chinese context. As I mentioned, the dramatic expansion, and there were so many new universities. And in the initial stage, those universities, they are very ambitious to model on the traditional university, offering the similar curriculum and programs, but they are not in that position to do that kind of thing because they don't have such a quality of the faculty crop. At the end of the day, you see this kind of the unemployment. What is the term? Unemployment, educated unemployment, right? So you see, so, the Chinese university graduates, they couldn't find the job. And nowadays, you have to bear that in mind. Chinese universities and colleges producing 7 million graduates every year. So quite a bit that couldn't find proper jobs. At the end of the day, the government is now creating a new initiatives to improve the relevance. As I mentioned, they try to convert 600 local universities, mostly the new universities, into the new type
university applied science. And I hope they can have close linkages and partnerships with the industry and with feedback and suggestions to improve their curriculum and also the training at universities. Another thing I want to mention is, I believe, to my knowledge, in the past decade or two, at least 200 Chinese institutions that changed their names from university college or from college to universities. So you can see this kind of the academic drift. But along with the academic drift, relevance is a big issue, is a big question. I can only talk that much. There's many things going on there. It's still ongoing process. But as I can observe, a problem in that process is whether or not industry is ready for that kind of a collaboration. You need information from industry in order to improve your curriculum and the programs. But the Chinese, traditional Chinese industries is not involved in R&D. But now they're getting only the big industries, but traditionally not. So it's pretty much how much feedback and assistance you can get from the industry. But this is a big initiative. Government is pushing forward. As I said, a strong government is a central feature for the Chinese system. And China somehow benefited from that feature. Maybe I can extend a little bit further to talk about, you know, most recently Francis Fukuyama, he wrote a book about the new notion of the well-governed society. We can translate that notion into the higher education system as well. And he mentioned three key elements. One is the strong government, a strong state. Second is rule by law. And third is democracy. And guess what? He said, a strong state should come first, followed by rule of law and the democracy. You can think about that. It's quite a challenging concept, right? So I guess China benefit a lot from that. The quality assurance. As I said, again, the Chinese government is creating and launching many assurance programs, evaluation programs, not only the central government. The central government more about those elite universities and national universities, top-tier universities. And local governments, they're taking care of their own universities to apply all kinds of the auditing missions and quality assurance evaluation programs. I think I should stop here and leave the rest to my colleagues. Okay.
Maybe Professor, I think Professor Yan has.
Can you use the mic?
Yeah, sure. I think Professor Yan has better knowledge and also a rich experience concerning the issues related to the better match between the graduates and the labor market needs, and also the issues related to the policy on concentrating resources on a few number of institutions. But I think I'm not a position myself, as a Chinese higher education expert or, policymaker side, because there's a lot of issues related to policy making, how the China, like Yoshi asked, how China is going to resolve the problem. I think I'm not in the position. As a researcher, I think as researchers, our role is more like raising the questions and make somebody aware of some important issues rather than offer the solutions. I hope, I wish I could, but I found that to me, this is first related to this world-class university policy. I think that is really related to how the policymaker think, what is important for China's sustainable development or economic growth. So far, I believe that the Chinese government ideology or their beliefs is on that elite will save China and we make China a great country. But personally, I think just my personal opinion, I thought about that. China is it's a huge country with a big population. The elite is good, but it's not sufficient to save the country. And if we see the economic structure of the developed economies, for example, in Europe, the economic growth is not dependent even on the first tier cities, but on the second tier cities. The capital cities are, you know, some big cities are only making a small a portion of the economic growth. But in China, there is a big gap. China is dependent on a few cities and some advanced provinces. I think if China want to learn the experience, because China want to catch up the developed economies, if China want to catch up, then they should learn the model of their economic development. If you want to boost up the second tier cities, they are mainly, you know, in the regions, you know, they need a different type of talents. So maybe they do not, you know, really get benefits from the world class, you know, so-called, you know, the 985 and the 211, you know, university. So this is about, you know, really about the beliefs of the Chinese policymakers, whether the elites are the savers of the Chinese economy or it is the quality of overall population make it work. So this is my short comment about that issue. I think there, I try to save, you know, more time to my colleague, Professor Yan.
I would like to have three additional points, three additional evidence. And one is this policy is not totally initiated by the government. It's actually, if we study the process, this program initiated by two universities. And my university and Tsinghua University. They are not for public purpose. They are for their self-interest because they want money from the government. What's the argument for money coming to the two universities? And they have ambition to be world-class universities. So that's the legitimacy for government give money to few universities instead of equalize financing to all universities. So I like the process perspective. If we look at the process, we can say what's the start point. And the second thing I think, and the still the government adopt the policy and the policy still exists. And in government perspective, their point of view, they think China want to be a strong country, strong state, and a strong university is very necessary. So that's the government still insist this policy. And the third one, I think, if we study the process of the world class university, the program changing. At the first, the government just gave money to around nine universities, and eventually the program expanded to 40 institutions. Why? Because other 13 universities compete for the resources, so the program expand its scope to 40 universities. So initially, the national government and also provincial government give money to institutions. They don't care how they spend the money. So some universities use the money wisely, some are not. That's the problem. And so this becomes a social problem. And the universities, the government changed their way to distribute the money. And recently, the money is not institutional based. It's a program based. And so the government launched some program. Any universities can compete for the resources, even provincial universities. If they work with some elite universities, they can apply resources. So by studying this process, we can see the government and the institutions become wider than they used to be. So I still like the perspective. And last, I would like to respond to the employment issue. Yes, that's a one problem, because Chinese government, the higher education system expand dramatically in the year 1999, and 47% increase in that particular year. The labor market cannot absorb the graduates. And if we look at the process, the government changed their policy. In the past, the provincial governments, they have restrictions. The students from provincial universities, they can find their job in the province. They got their education. And because the problem, the poor province, they cannot satisfy their job, so the provincial lose their restriction, students can move. They can move from the poor regions, they got their education, higher education, to rich province. They have a bright prospect for their employment. So if we study the process, we can have some interesting finding. And lastly, I think the 1999 higher education expansion, if we have two perspectives to study higher education expansion, in the long run, human capital can explain why university system expansion. But in Chinese context, in the year 1999, I think in very, very short time, the higher education expansion 47% increase. That's ridiculous, I think, from the rational perspective. But if we look at the very special context and very special difficulty Chinese economy met in that year, and we can use the process or institutional perspective to interpret in that particular year, higher education expansion is so dramatically.
Well, thank you very much.
Can I check whether yes, Dr. He has anything to say? As I mentioned, Dr. He, do you have anything to say? Dr. He from the Ford Foundation.
Two points. One is the reason that China is after GDP all the time is for each percentage point in GDP, China can create about over a million jobs. So each year, if the GDP goes down, it won't be able to maintain the job provision. And so right now, each year, China provides about 10 million new jobs. And when you think we have more than 7 million college graduates, and only like 20 to 30% people go to college. So that's a big issue to answer to Professor Josh, just to give him some background. The other thing I want to say is, from a foundation's perspective, if we talk about higher ed, where China's problem is, there are four big parties involved: the government, the students, university, and the labor market. And the China's problem is, the good things is brought by the government, but the bad things also. It's the government is too strong and it's over involved. It controls everything. So the other three parties, labor market, students, and university, they can't really play their roles as they should, as they see fit. So the problem is from government, so the solution is in the government, not in the others. But right now, the government could not cut its own, could not really give the power, decide to where to shrink its authority to let others play their own roles properly. I think that's where the problem comes from.
Being our representative and the distinguished speakers as well. Thank you very much.